Good morning, everybody. I would like to say warm welcome to our kickoff of our webcast with the topic Future of Ukraine, with a focus to speak about potential for German business, but also to support Ukraine in the current situation. I would like to say, it's a topic of my heart, because Ukraine is in a very difficult situation, and that means, to support Ukraine, also to be solidarity with Ukraine, and to think about how we can help Ukraine. Not only to speak about the war, but our job is also to take a look into the future, to be optimistic, and to create a better future in the interest of Ukraine. In this respect, I would like to move to my next slide and introduce my colleagues who are speaking with me today at this webcast. First of all, my name is Jobst Wilmans. I'm international tax partner, transfer pricing partner at Deloitte Germany. I'm also a member of the Global Transfer Pricing Executive Board and heading the German transfer pricing practice. With me is Fabian Magstedt, partner colleague here in Germany in consulting. His key topic is Future of Ukraine, and he will speak later. In addition, and also to say really very warm welcomes to my colleagues from Ukraine. First of all, Dmitry Pavlenko. He's a partner in Kyiv and head of the tax and legal practice. With him is Alexander Yapolsky. He is my counterpart in international tax transfer pricing in the Ukraine practice. In addition, I would like to say warm welcomes to Vasily Dubov. He's a corporate tax director, specialized very much in international taxation, and he can tell you a little bit more from an international and national tax perspective what is the appropriate framework to invest in future in Ukraine. And with him is Anton Bykov, senior manager in the legal group, and he is reflecting potential investments, especially from a legal perspective. So again, thank you very much to all the speakers who are with me today. Now I would like to move to the next slide and give you a short introduction to the agenda of today. Yeah, actually, I'm doing the introduction. After me, together with Dimitrov, afterwards, we will take an over. Vasily Dubov will give you an overview of the Ukraine economy of today and tomorrow. Afterwards, Alexander will speak about the tax environment in Ukraine. Vasily Dubov will speak about investments perspective, more from the business perspective. And after the end, we can also share our experience from a Deloitte, from a global Deloitte perspective, from a Ukraine Deloitte perspective, but also from a German Deloitte perspective, how we can support you and help you in your business expansion. Starting with the first slide, as mentioned, Ukraine is a topic of our heart. And for us, it's not only to speak about the present, but also to speak about the future. That means to speak how we can find a bridge between the business in Germany and Ukraine. It's not only the military industry. Many industries in Germany are present, and many industries are willing to support Ukraine in recovering the actual situation and to create a better future. Secondly, from our perspective, it's absolutely of importance also to speak how we can be a pioneer in the recovery and rebuilding of the Ukraine companies. And last but not least, there are many, many topics. Yeah, we would like to speak also how we can, as Deloitte, how we can support this development. I'm a tax specialist, international tax specialist, and now I would like to move to the next slide. And in this respect, yeah, what we can see from an international national tax perspective, there are many, many programs, yeah, in place. Multinational companies with an interest to invest or to run business in Ukraine can use. Yeah, that means Ukraine is, first of all, OECD member. And that means, yeah, OECD is following in general the OECD standards. And in consequence, if we are speaking about international taxation, and there are not big differences between the tax system in Germany, in Ukraine, from the taxable system, but also from the double taxation framework. I think Ukraine has an existing running taxation framework, and here I'm absolutely sure that we can, that we can find not to create any double taxation cases. The European Union has set up a number of frameworks. Actually, the European Union has introduced an investment framework with a volume of 50 billion euro. And here you can see there are many, many baskets multinational companies can use. Including, and that is also the bridge between the European Union and Germany. It's not only basket, it's also institutions which are supporting you from the taxable system, from the incentive system, but also from, from the financing perspective. Yeah, that means there are a number of banks and institutions who are giving you from the financial perspective support. Yeah, and that is a topic, yeah, we will cover in a later stage of our presentation of today. Now I would like to hand over to my colleagues of Ukraine, first of all, to give an introduction from their perspective, and afterwards also to speak about the current situation. You are still on mute.
Jobst, danke schon, and greetings from Ukraine to everybody. Thank you, colleagues, for attending our webinar today. As Jobst already presented myself, I am Dmytro Pavlenko. I'm a lawyer and the partner with Deloitte Ukraine, leading our tax and legal practice. And we are here today to talk to you about an opportunity for German businesses looking to set up presence and launch new business in Ukraine. During this presentation, I will introduce our dream team to you and showcase the business-friendly environment in Ukraine and highlight the services we can offer to support your venture in Ukraine. And first of all, I would like to take a moment to extend our sincere gratitude to Germany, to your government, and to all German people for their unwavering support through both humanitarian and military aid for Ukraine, which is very essential for us. And exciting developments are on the horizon as Germany and Ukraine come together to jointly host a large Ukraine recovery conference in Germany in June. It will take place in Berlin. And this is the first such a conference hosted in an EU member state, one of the most significant ones, and it comes at a crucial time for Ukraine. And we, Deloitte Ukraine, provide some support to our clients and the government in order to make the event as practical as possible and to introduce specific investment opportunities from Ukrainian business and Ukrainian government. My colleague Fabian will speak about the conference a bit more later today. And in this context, just one example, recently I spoke to a German colleague who used to be a top official of one of the large German business. And now he is a member of a board of my Ukrainian client. And during a meeting, he said to another potential foreign counterparty that large companies will be hunting for business in Ukraine soon. They will be hunting for business in Ukraine. And I can add in this respect that recent aid from US, from UK and other allies is an important context here too. And another essential aspect of business attractiveness of Ukraine in upcoming future is our approximation to European Union. Now, let me introduce a bit more Deloitte Ukraine. We are proud to have a highly skilled and expertise workforce with over 30 years of combined expertise. Within our office, we have more than 500 employees, and I represent, and my colleagues represent here specialized tax and legal department led by myself and comprising more than 100 dedicated tax and legal professionals. Together, we helped numerous businesses successfully establish and grow their operations in Ukraine, and our team is ready to guide and support you as well. Some more details about our office will be presented on the next slide. And I also would like to emphasize that our office in Kyiv is open and ready to welcome you. Absolute majority of our people are located in Kyiv now, and we work on the ground with our clients and state authorities. We understand all the challenges that foreign companies often face when entering a new market, even under normal conditions. But the war has unprecedented complexity and uncertainty to the matter. However, we are here to make this journey as smooth as possible for you. And our extensive knowledge of local regulations and practices ensures that all the necessary formalities and market specifics will be taken care of efficiently. Now, let's take a moment to recognize the German companies that are already operating in Ukraine and who are providing our services. We are proud to have partnered with numerous successful organizations from various industries, and they have found great opportunities and continued operations and sometimes even growth in the market for these days. And their presence is a testament of the potential of Ukraine as a destination for new foreign investors. And you can see the brands on just several the most bright companies we would like to present on this and next slide. And just to mention only one, we are proud to be tax and legal advisor to Container Terminal Odessa, which is located in Odessa Seaport, and is a part of HHLA, which is Hamburg Hafen and Logistic group of companies. And HHLA is the biggest German investor to Ukrainian economy and the biggest investor to Ukrainian infrastructure. And I want to highlight also developments in military sector, where German defense companies such as Rheinmetalle and Quantum Systems have established their presence in Ukraine quite recently. And Rheinmetalle is a Deloitte Global Audit client. At this note, I would like to pass the word to my colleague, Vasil Drobat, who is a leader of a corporate tax group at Deloitte Ukraine. Vasil, over to you.
Thank you, Dmitro. Thank you, everybody, for joining our webinar. I'm a leader of a corporate tax group here in Deloitte Kyiv office. And in addition to my duties, I also often speak about the state of the Ukrainian economy right now, because I try to promote investment into Ukraine on various events. And you can't really talk about investment without acknowledging the current economic situation in Ukraine and considering the real feeling of doing business in Ukraine from the person that is currently in Kyiv and seeing the scenes as they unfold. Next slide, please. So we all know that there is currently, unfortunately, a large-scale war in Ukraine, and there's few things in the world less conducive for doing business and investment as full-scale war. However, I would say there is still a lot of opportunities in Ukraine, and the Ukrainian economy has been surprisingly resilient despite all the challenges that we are facing. So to put this thing in the right perspective, yes, 18% of the Ukrainian territory is occupied, mostly in the east. And as you can see, the east is also the side where most of the fighting is going and where the most of the attacks are focused. So the central part of the country and the western part of the country, I wouldn't say that the life is completely normal. However, the business, the economy are operational, and the businesses that are located there and a lot of businesses from eastern Ukraine have relocated to the central and western part, and they are working almost normally. So Ukraine had a significant decline in GDP in 2022, 29%, as could be expected from the events that were unfolded in Ukraine. However, Ukrainian economy has sort of rebounded since then overall. So as you can see on the next slide, and by the way, next slide, please. Ukraine has managed to achieve economic growth in 2023 of 5.7% and has managed to put an annual inflation down, which is a great achievement during the wartime. And it's also an indication that the economy has stayed strong and continued to operate. I would also want to put this in into perspective by saying that the large fall in GDP of 29% in 2022 is also attributed by the fact that 18% of territory got occupied and all the production of the territories are not counted into the GDP of 2022 and 2023. Considering all the people also live in Ukraine, almost 20% of population relocated to Europe running away from the war, actually the GDP per capita in 2023 likely has increased over even 2021 pre-war year. And from a very personal perspective of a tax consultant working in Ukrainian current business environment, I could say that almost all our clients, well over 90%, are operational in Ukraine and increasing their investment into Ukrainian businesses and even making profits. Next slide, please. So this is also could be seen in the prognosis for the Ukrainian GDP, which by all accounts, both Ukrainian government, international institutions like IMF, World Bank, they remain positive. And I would say a moderate growth is expected to happen in Ukraine over the following next few years. Of course, this is contingent on the stable or improving situation on the battlefields. That's understandable, but there's also very positive news in this respect. The support from European Union countries, including and especially Germany, has been very strong recently, and we are very grateful for that. There is also a recent news that you may heard of your United States passing a big defense bill with support for Ukraine. So this also adds confidence for the business that they can plan for the future and they can plan a development and operations in Ukraine and the condition would not get worse dramatically and hopefully would even get better. And again, I want to stress that the business is going. Ukraine has actually in 2023 increased its exports compared to 2022, and the unblocking of sea routes helped a lot. So currently the grain corridor and some other export is going through the sea routes as it was before the war, and overall Ukrainian economy has refocused itself on new export route and focused a lot on the European countries and exporting to them. Also, the main products of Ukrainian export remain quite, I would say, resource-based. So it's grains, it's agricultural products, it's metals, it's ore. There is also a big growing industry of what is called other on the slide, but what this other represent, it's the service industries, especially such as IT and other, I would say, certain high-tech production and more modern competitive industries. And actually, Ukraine remains a big importer of the machinery, of engineering goods, of complex produced materials. So Ukrainian people love consumer electronic cars produced in Western countries, and again, especially Germany. So it's a lot of opportunity to do business and to sell them in Ukraine. And this GDP growth, which we talked about, is also largely attributed to the strong consumer demand, because again, due to the big international support, and Ukrainian businesses actively working, paying taxes, the government is able to pay salaries to its employees, to soldiers, the businesses pay salary to its to their employees, and therefore there is still strong consumer demand going on in Ukraine, and that helps to drive the economy and produce the GDP growth, even under these very stressful and very strange and uncertain conditions for the country. Next slide, please. Again, Ukrainian people try to adapt to the war conditions, and in 2022 and 2023, we actually saw a great increase in the amount of small and medium-sized businesses opening. As you can see on the slide, the numbers are quite big, so there's over 37,000 companies being registered, new companies, there's almost 300,000 of private entrepreneurs, like people there, owning their own small business, being registered and doing work in Ukraine. And also the foreign direct investment amount, which fully collapsed in the year 2022, has been recovering ever since. And currently we see more and more interest as Deloitte in purchasing Ukrainian businesses and interest to invest in Ukraine. And it has been growing basically for all of 2023. And even now, we see more and more action in M&A sector, for example, which was, I would say, totally non-existent in 2022. So it's also a sign that foreign companies are looking into Ukraine, and there is opportunity to do investment activity even during the war. And of course, we expect that when the situation stabilizes, there would be even more foreign direct investment coming in. And I want also to talk about why Ukraine may be a country interesting for investing, even under current peculiar conditions, and why it may be very lucrative and attractive as an investment destination overall, especially considering the future that is bound to come, the peaceful future. Next slide, please. So, geographically speaking, Ukraine is located at the doorstep of the EU. It shares very large border with European Union nation states. And of course, that allows for an opportunity to establish production in Ukraine and export goods to Europe with little of hassle in terms of logistics and little logistics cost, while benefiting from a very educated workforce, which is a lot cheaper than currently the workforce in European Union. And overall, Ukraine has a very, I would say, vibrant startup environment. So Ukrainian people overall are very innovative, and this tendency towards innovation, it's actually what helps Ukrainian people to stay afloat during these troublesome times, because in order to do business, in order to earn money and keep the economy functioning, Ukrainian businesses have to adapt, have to be very resilient, and have to modernize themselves very rapidly and invent new ways how to do business. So I would say doing business in Ukraine is the opportunity to be a part of most rapidly modernizing economy in the world. Because without the modernization, Ukraine would not be a prosperous and well-standing nation as we want it to be. And that actually opens great opportunities because Ukraine needs new technologies, it needs new approaches in terms of energy efficiency, in terms of infrastructure. When we are talking about rebuilding Ukraine, it's not the goal to rebuild Ukraine as it was, with old crumbling Soviet infrastructure. It's a goal to rebuild it as a new model 21st century country. And as also was mentioned in the beginning of this webinar, Ukrainian legislation is largely in terms of taxes and corporate law is based on OECD and EU guidelines. So it's not hard to understand it. And Ukraine has actually very low barriers for starting a business. Starting a business is very easy. And in terms of course, risk cost of the war, there's a war risk insurance available, which we will talk in detail a little bit later with my colleague Anton. And overall, given the upcoming and hopefully soon ascension of the Ukraine to the EU, or at least close the economic ties between Ukraine and the EU, almost all countries that joined the EU or were moving towards this joining, they experienced significant economic growth. So it's very good to be the first one to come to the market and to prosper with your Ukrainian businesses from this economic growth that is to come. And I would say that it's a gamble worth taking right now. And this brings me to the industries which we believe are the most prospective one and the most hottest one, so to sell, for investment. This list was compiled by us here in Deloitte Ukraine. However, it also corresponds with the assessment of our Ministry of Economy, EBRD, and we've seen a lot of interrupts with similar list that other international organization institutions produce. So what we believe is the industries that would allow to generate the most profit and the most growth are military and defense industries. This is kind of a self-explanatory. Ukraine is fighting the war, and even when the war is over, we will still live with very large and very aggressive neighbor to the east. And Ukraine would have to be armed, would have to produce a lot of weapons to be self-sufficient. And Ukraine is also a pioneer currently in a very new fields of war technologies, such as drones and automated fighting systems. So there is a lot of possibility for R&D partnership and a lot of money allocated from the state to the industries. So it's certainly an industry where there is demand, and where there is demand, there is growth and opportunity to earn profits. The other industry which almost become as a traditional strength of Ukraine is the Ukrainian IT industry. It has been rapidly growing through the last 10 years, and it's still rapidly growing even now. There is constantly new companies popping out from in Ukrainian IT scene. And Ukraine has been a home country for a few billion dollar startups, like maybe you heard about Grammarly, you heard about MacPo, and Ukraine is home for big outsourcing IT companies, which employ thousands of developers. And Ukraine is famous for its talented IT developers, so it offers a great opportunity for expansion in terms of IT businesses. Also, the industries that would be very hot and very in demand is construction, and in particular, production of building materials. One of the large building materials manufacturing company from Europe already building a new plant from scratch in Ukraine with an investment of almost 300 million euros. And there is still a lot of market to be gained there because demand for new construction will be huge. It's even huge right now with building all the fortification, but it will only grow in the when the war is over. So it's good to invest now, build a production facility, and be able to cover the demand in terms of construction materials. The next industry, which also Ukraine is famous for, is agriculture. Ukraine has a very productive soils, and it allows to get a great harvest. And Ukraine has been very successful as an agricultural goods exporter. And there is also a lot of necessity to demine the agricultural fields and cultivate them anew after the hostilities cease. So there is a great opportunities to be had there, and a lot of land probably would change hands in the near future. So agriculture, like you know, the food is always in demand across the world, and Ukraine is a great place to produce food products. The next industry is infrastructure, multimodal hubs, and logistic complexes. As I said, it's the strength of Ukraine, it's its closeness with European markets. And if you set up production here, if you have the proper logistics, it's quite lucrative to export the products to EU. So there would also be a great demand, for instance, for infrastructural projects, both in terms of upcoming reconstruction and in terms of reorienting the Ukrainian businesses to Europe, which is already happening. There is an increased demand for modernization of railway roads, of ports on the Danube River. So this investment is in infrastructure is already happening even right now. It will only grow in the future, in our opinion. And the last but not the least is energy production and energy networks. You probably heard that Ukrainian energy network suffered very high damage due to the Russian attacks. The energy production also suffered greatly, especially in the recent months. So there's a huge demand for new power plants, and there's a huge demand for building very decentralized energy system, which would be resilient for these attacks. And that also opens opportunity for new technologies being introduced in Ukraine and new energy development methods and distributions methods. And the demand is great from both the states, the Ukrainian power companies, and Ukrainian population, even for the small energy production. And before the war, Ukraine was also a great hub for building solar power plants, wind power plants. We had a lot of companies investing into that. And now a lot of companies still successfully produce renewable energy and sell it in these high prices to the Ukrainian energy system. And we also expect that since a lot of like legacy generative capacity have been taken down, like coal plants, thermal power plants, there is a great opportunity to build new renewable power plants. So that's also would be a hot energy or hot industry for investment. Thank you very much. I will pass the word to my colleague Alexander, who would talk with you more about the tax environment in Ukraine and how your business may fare from the tax viewpoint, and some things to look into if you plan investing in Ukraine or take interest in doing business with Ukrainian companies.
Thanks, Vasil, and guten Tag, Freunde. Today we won't be able to cover comprehensively all matters on the tax environment in Ukraine, but let's discuss some key elements which could provide you with some background and overview on the tax landscape in Ukraine. So firstly, let's touch upon the basic tax rates. In Ukraine, the current corporate tax rate stands at 18%. This rate, I would say, is relatively competitive compared to other countries in the region. VAT rate is 20%, the personal income tax rate is flat and equal to 18%. And military tax is 1.5%. Let's figure out how these taxes contribute to the state budget, which was approximately 30, 3 billion. Let's move on just a little bit. Thanks. So the state budget was approximately 73 billion dollars in 2023. State-owned entities play a significant role, contributing 30% of the budget, while VAT contributes 22%. Personal income tax and corporate tax each contribute 8 and 5% respectively. Despite this contribution, the state budget does face a deficit. Given the deficits, the role of the international donors has become increasingly important nowadays. International donors contribute 16% of the total state budget. So this underscores the efforts between Ukraine and the international community and address some fiscal challenges. Now let's shift our focus on to the general legislative tax framework. Ukraine prides itself on adhering to international standards in tax legislation and striving to demonstrate a commitment to transparency and fairness. One significant aspect of our legislative framework is the harmonization with EU legislation. So Ukraine recognizes the importance of integrating with European norms and has been actively working towards aligning its tax laws with the laws of the European Union. This includes implementing anti-BEPS measures first. Moreover, Ukraine has embraced transfer pricing regulation that are largely based on the OECD principles. When it comes to VAT, Ukraine has its own VAT system that is separate from the European Union regulation, but Ukraine has made efforts to align its tax legislation with international standards, including some aspects of EU VAT directive. Ukraine has signed double tax treaties with numerous countries, and as of now, Ukraine has entered into double tax treaties with over 70 countries worldwide, including Germany. And in summary, Ukraine's tax legislative framework reflects a commitment to international standards. Tax environment for sure is affected by the martial law, and we will talk about this on the next slide. So, tax audits and regulatory. Now, let's address the impact of martial law on the tax environment in Ukraine, particularly in the light of Russian invasion. So, back in the COVID outbreak times, the ban on the tax audits had been imposed and it was extended during the war. However, last year, this ban has been partially lifted up. The Ukrainian tax authority have issued a tax audit plan outlined the list of the companies are to be audited. And scheduled tax audits of a new group of taxpayers may commence not early than 2 calendar months after the updated audit plan is announced. When it comes to the duration of the tax audits, it varies depending on the type of audit. Then generally tax audits last from 10 to 50 business days. Transfer pricing audits can be more extensive, lasting up to 2.5 years. And given the significant portion of export of commodities that Vasil has already mentioned, the tax authority placed a particular focus on the transactions involving commodities, especially regarding transfer pricing audits. Lastly, let's touch upon currency restrictions. So with the invasion, the National Bank of Ukraine imposed restrictions on the purchase of foreign currency and cross-border transactions. However, it was allowed to pay for the goods included in the list of critical imports. It was back in 2022. And been very responsive to the needs of the business, the National Bank and the Cabinet Minister of Ukraine continue to gradually reduce the currency restrictions, and they that was introduced in the early period of the war. So the import of all commercial products has been actually allowed, and their respective payments are allowed. However, there are some restrictions still apply to the payment for the specific services, work, intellectual property rights, and etc. So let's move to the next slide, please, and let's talk about some hot topics in Ukraine. So currently, there are a number of tax and legal topics on the agenda of the businesses which are operational in Ukraine. To us, it's a strong indicator that the businesses are operational in Ukraine. There are some topics which become relevant after the COVID outbreak, and during the war, its significance drastically increased. The first is transfer pricing. So during the COVID times, we observed the trend when some companies incurred losses, and for sure, after the full-scale invasion, the Ukrainian companies experienced extraordinary expenses. They lost the assets and faced a decline of the revenue. This led to the accumulation of the operating losses. Now the companies strive to substantiate these losses from the transfer pricing perspective and develop the approach how to do this. Moreover, since 2021, the Ukrainian law foresees such concept as deemed dividend. This concept means that transfer pricing adjustment may be treated as dividends and withholding tax could be charged. The company could benefit from the double tax treaty and exempt from the taxation of withholding tax or apply reduced withholding tax rate. Another important consideration for the Ukrainian businesses is the implementation of electronic document management system. The Ukrainian law allows the company to implement EDM and what is important for tax purposes as well. So let me recall that EDM refers to the process of creating, storing, organizing, and managing documents in a digital format. It involves the use of the special software, and EDM is important for businesses operating in Ukraine, especially during the wartime, for, I would say, three reasons. So the first is the accessibility. The second is security, which means that digital documents can be encrypted and protected with access controls. And the third is the disaster recovery. So in the event of damage or destruction of physical infrastructure, electronic documents can be easily backed up. Safety file, standard audit file for tax, has emerged as a critical tool for business in Ukraine. So again, briefly, let me briefly recall what is safety. So safety file is an international standard for electronic data file that's used to facilitate the exchange of accounting and tax information between business and the tax authority. Safety file contains detailed information about a company's financial transactions, sales, purchase invoices, general ledger, etc., etc. And now large taxpayers in Ukraine are required to provide safety file at the request of the authority, tax authority, during the tax audit. In addition, in the future, it's planned that from next year, from 2025, safety file will become regular annual tax reporting for large taxpayers. And last but not least is the authorized economic operator status. So this status, in a nutshell, this status simplifies customs procedures. The Institute of Authorized Economic Operator has existed in Ukraine since 2019, and the implementation of this institute in Ukraine contributes to the harmonization, again, harmonization of the customs legislation of Ukraine to the European Union standard. So the companies with this status, with the status of authorized economic operator, can receive quick and easier access and simplification to the customs clearance procedure, effective use of custom resources for some control procedures in relation to the goods they imported, and simplify interaction with customs authority and online communication. So now more and more companies are obtaining this status in Ukraine. So thank you for your time, and hope that today's our discussion regarding this part, regarding the part of tax environment in Ukraine, brought some broad overview on the current tax environment. So let's move on, and I'm passing the word to Vasil and Anton, right?
Yes, thank you, Alexander. So together with my colleague Anton, we want to talk a little bit about Ukrainian privilege tax regime and opportunities for investors and war insurance. So I would start with the overview of these tax regimes and then pass the word to Anton with respect to war insurance and certain legal aspects of these regimes. So as you can see, Ukraine does not have very much of in terms of preferential regimes, but it do have some. So first of all, there is opportunity to enter into production sharing agreement with the Ukrainian government. This is only allowed for the companies which produce certain commodities and hydrocarbons. However, it offers very preferential treatment. The company is exempt or is completely exempt, or CIT and VAT could be paid at lower rates or paid with basically goods that the company produced. These product sharing agreements were popular before 2014, where there was the expectation that large natural resources would be extracted from east of Ukraine and the Black Sea seashelf. However, of course, due to current events, this project has been shelved. However, in the future, they may emerge, and this product sharing agreement special tax regime may become very viable for the companies which want to invest in these areas. Also, there is industrial parks. There is a lot of them across Ukraine, and the participation in the industrial parks offers the company, first of all, it's a compensation of interest rate on loans from the state. So more than 50% of interest could be compensated from the state budgets on loan taken to develop the business. And in addition, there is also the exemption from local taxes, certain municipal taxes like land tax, the tax on the usage of water resources. They're not very material in terms of business, so it's not like corporate tax or VAT, but still it's certain relief for the companies that enter into this industrial park. The special tax regime, which was only introduced in 2022 and since then become very, very popular, and over 1,000 companies are already enjoying the benefits of this tax regime, is DSCT. DSCT is the regime available only for the IT companies. However, I would say it's the most efficient and most lucrative special tax regime in Ukraine. So what it offers? It offers the company that produces software or does high-tech R&D or provides certain IT professional services. These companies may not pay the profit tax entirely. They may pay profit tax only from the profits distributed to their shareholders and certain transactions equated to the distributions of profit to the shareholders, like payment of interest abroad, royalties, etc. In addition to the ability to avoid paying corporate tax, they also have an ability to pay preferential tax rate, to use preferential tax rate from the salaries paid to their employees. So the basic personal income tax rate in Ukraine is 18%. However, the companies that join DSCT tax regime, it's allowed to tax the income that it pays to its employees only at 5%. So basically, it's more than 3 times reduction in personal income tax. And consequently, these companies, city companies that join the city tax regime, can pay a more competitive salaries to its employees, and therefore attract a top talent compared to other companies. It also allows to avoid the great tax scheme which was used in Ukraine previously, where IT company in mass engaged individuals as private contractors, where in fact they were employees. So these tax regimes covers that and offers the same tax benefits for employees as if they were engaged as private contractors before, which is very lucrative for Ukrainian IT industry. Anton, over to you.
Yeah, thank you, Vasil. I just want to add in regards of legal advantages of DSCT regulatory regime. Yeah, the keystone in IT industry is a cooperation between the company and the IT specialist. And one of the main advantage of this regime, DSCT regime, is that it introduces new form of cooperation between the business, between the company and IT specialist, is a gig contract. It's very convenient, and actually it became answer and a compromise between between the government and between the business in terms of possible ways to cooperate with the IT specialist. And within DSCT regime, you can use the standard classical form of employment with IT employees. You can use a gig contract, and you can use already famous and standard mechanism of cooperation with IT specialist in Ukraine is a work with physical persons entrepreneurs. The only thing that the volume of cooperation with physical persons entrepreneurs should be reduced. And DSCT regime is also convenient in terms of automatic protection of IP rights, possibility to use of mechanism to support startups, conversion of loan into the capital, and other useful mechanism, corporate mechanism to work with IT industry. We see the tendency that this regime became very popular. Now we have more than 900 residents of DSCT regime in Ukraine, and the tendency of the last year is that the companies that are originally not from IT industry, for example, agriculture or processing industry, or even banking, they are creating their IT arms and make these IT arms, digital arms, residents of the DSCT because it's very convenient and beneficial for business. One more mechanism to support investments in Ukraine is directly focus on foreign direct investments. It's a state support for investment project with significant investments. This mechanism was introduced before the war, and recently the requirements for the investment projects to be eligible for state support drastically reduced. So basically, to be eligible for state support, the project should be 12 million euro or more, should imply investments. 10 or more new jobs, should create 10 or more new jobs, and should be within the wide list of possible areas of investments. It's processing industry, manufacturing, R&D, education, wide range of industries. What can be this state support? Actually, state supports can be in the form of compensation of corporate income tax. It can be in the form of compensation VAT for imported equipment. It can be in the form of compensation for connection with engineering or logistic infrastructure, compensation of payments for the land use, and so on. The general state support shouldn't exceed 30% of the investment investment project. Basically, there is a one governmental institution, Ukraine Invest, who is responsible for supporting and provision of support to the investors according to this mechanism. We internally call this mechanism like investment NANI. Investment NANI mechanism, because Ukraine Invest allocates special manager to help the companies investing in Ukraine to work with this mechanism, to look for appropriate facilities, locations, and so on. One more important recent introduction to this mechanism is that the company may start investment project and in parallel apply for state support with all the documentation, feasibility study. The company may do it in parallel with implementation of the investment project. Previously, it was not possible. Now, you the company can apply for support in parallel with the implementation of the investment. This is a high level overview of the main legal incentives, and now we want to provide small overview of insurance mechanisms that are available. Basically, we understand that for business, especially working within a situation of war, it is important to have some mechanism to ensure or protect or guarantee investments. And there are several options developed already on Ukrainian market. First of all, this is initiatives from the government of Ukraine. Several months ago, it was introduced new law on insurance of investments in Ukraine against military risks through the mechanism of export credit agency. Mainly, this mechanism developed to support companies already established, already present in Ukraine and maintaining export activity. But also there are some possibilities to companies entering Ukrainian market to use this mechanism. In general, the main body responsible for insurance market in Ukraine is the National Bank of Ukraine, and now it's this institution establishing a concept, complex concept of functional war risk insurance system. And we expect that enabling regulations will be adopted in summer this year to establish full market of insurance against war risk and political risk in Ukraine. Basically, these are mechanisms that are focused on business already presented in Ukraine. And there are other mechanisms for investors who are considering the possibility to invest in Ukraine. First of all, is a mechanism that was introduced by MIGA. It's a World Bank International Investment Guarantee Agency to that in autumn previous year they developed a mechanism of ensuring private investors investing in Ukraine during the war. And we have already several cases when this mechanism was applied. The first one was in autumn previous year. It was regarding the project of creation logistic complex industrial park close to Lviv, Western Ukraine. And the insurance guarantee mechanism covered military risk for 10 years. Also, several countries, the governments of several countries announced and introduced insurance mechanism for businesses from these countries for the purposes of investing in Ukraine. And in autumn previous year, it was announced by Federal Republic of Germany that they introducing investment guarantee scheme for the businesses from Germany planning to invest in Ukraine. And additional key mechanism that will be enabler for the next years, as you know, and as my colleagues mentioned, European Union already approved mechanism recovery mechanism for Ukraine facility for 50 billion. For 50 billion for 3 years. And a part of this mechanism is Ukraine investment facility for 9.1 billion. Basically, as we understand, this mechanism plan to support private investments in Ukraine, to rebuild Ukraine. Already the steering committee of this Ukraine investment framework already introduced. And according to announcements from European Union and from government of Ukraine, through the application of this 9.1 billion in the form of guarantees, in the form of financial mixed financing and other stimulus, it's planned to mobilize to mobilize around 40 billion of private investments. That's just a plan, we understand, but now it's a way to implementation of this ambition plan. It is announced also that the first investment programs will be shown at the Berlin conference and in the middle of the June. So we are waiting for more concrete steps in investment programs under this framework. That's all regarding the insurance and the incentives for investments. I passing the word to my colleagues who will continue with our abilities to support business.
Thank you, Anton, for your comprehensive comments. And finally, let me highlight the range of services we offer to support your business endeavors in Ukraine. And going from comprehensive market research and feasibility studies to screening potential business partners, we have the expertise to help you make well-grounded decisions. And many prospective investors are at business intelligence stage now, looking at Ukrainian market, and we collect macroeconomic and specific industrial data for some of them. And as a lawyer, I also want to underline our expertise on legal support of business setup, various contractual schemes and scenarios, different forms of PPPs, JVs, etc. And we also on a daily basis address current legal challenges, such as martial law, peculiarities, currency control matters, labor law, and many other things. And additionally, being a tax and legal practice, we're well positioned in tax advisory, compliance and reporting and transfer pricing, ensuring that your business operations remain fully compliant with local regulations and investments are planned properly from tax perspective. And as a conclusion, with a dedicated team, open office and a wide range of services, we are ready and eager to support German businesses in Ukraine and to be a one-stop shop for all your business needs. Yeah. Please note, let me thank you for your attention and to say that we're looking forward to discussing the possibilities future with you and in more details. And I would like here to pass the word to my colleague, Fabian Markstadt, partner in consulting and Deloitte Germany.
Yeah, thank
Fabian,
you.
Over to you.
Yeah, thank you, Dimitro. But maybe we start with answering the question, because I will go a little bit away from the tax-specific topic. And so maybe it's good that we first go back to the question that I saw coming up in the chat.
Okay, yeah. First of all, let me mention that you, our guests, are in a position to write down your questions to the chat of our webcast, and we are ready to answer right now or later. If you will specify who you are, we can follow up after the webcast as well.
So far we have one question from Katarina. Will Pillar 2 be implemented in Ukraine? So it's a very good question. This question is on the table of most large world businesses. And this question is on its agenda. So far, Pillar 2 has not been implemented in Ukraine. We are not aware of any draft law on Pillar 2 in Ukraine, but we know that there are some talks and the level of the government regarding Pillar 2. Based on our experience, we see that Ukraine is following all EU, all worldwide, let's say, tax standards and initiatives, and this related to anti-BEPS measures, and Ukraine implemented these measures with some delay of 4-3 years. So probably Pillar 2 would be on the agenda going forward in Ukraine.
Okay. Yeah, let me maybe shift gears a little bit if we move to the next slide. And first of all, thank you all very much, first and foremost, our participants and Ukraine team for that very deep insight on the market prosperity opportunities and how this can be leveraged going forward. I would like to extend the perspective a little bit. I'm in charge of bringing together our European Deloitte practices as part of our global Future of Ukraine initiative to help public institutions and private institutions to engage proficiently into the rebuild of the country. And maybe as an upfront remark, we made that point already, but I would like to strengthen it. The initial intuition when thinking of rebuild of Ukraine is something like Marshall Plan some 70, 80 years back in Germany, or looking into the extension of EU, like the accession of Poland or of Czech Republic, for example, as examples. This is not the case, because the country, as the colleagues mentioned nicely, is one of the fastest growing countries in Europe. So the economy has suffered from war, but it is very clear that the economy is recovering very quickly from a lower base, obviously, because there is 20% of the country roughly under occupation, and they don't produce to the GDP, obviously. However, the remainder part is fastest growing and will recover to the level before war with a smaller extension roughly in a year from now if the projections are accurate. So this is to be in mind. We have a country in war, which at the same time is one of the fastest growing countries that we have in Europe. And this talks for itself as the testimony of the business opportunity. With that said, we as Deloitte, we have engaged in Ukraine 20 years back. So it's not that I'm talking about Ukraine merely as an engagement point for our global practice, but we are simply, as you said, Dimitro, we are in Kiev, our offices are open, we are working. We have been one of the first professional services firm that has withdrawn full operations from Russia. And our practice has moved into Poland to some extent, but we are now fully back on the ground operational in Ukraine. That is important to know. And I think the insights from our colleagues were a great testimony of us being on site. On the global level and on the European level, we are trying to bring together what is a quite a miracle task, the government of Ukraine priorities that are to some extent laid out in the recovery plan of Ukraine government. However, this is an evolving plan, obviously. We are closely collaborating, that you can see on the right-hand side, with donor organization and other development partners globally. And it's our firm belief that the engagement of private sector, so I'm very happy that we start this series here of webinars across different of our capabilities, to engage private sector, because roughly, and it doesn't matter whether we believe that it's 500 billion of restoration costs or whether it's a trillion of restoration costs, so there's, depending on the way you count it, different figures around in the public discussion. This doesn't matter so much. What matters is to understand that in all the extrapolations, there is an 80-20 rule, so 20 coming out of public and 80 coming out of private. And this is exactly where we try to play a differentiating role to enable scaling solutions for Ukraine through bringing together governments, donor organizations, and the private sector. And important, if we move to the next slide, an important milestone in our overall journey that we are on together with global firms. This is a German lens or an international lens to some extent. So we are representing our initiative and our engagement for Ukraine on very different events. So just back from Hannover Messe, and we were also present at Munich Security Conference, obviously to represent us as a firm, but also to raise a voice on what we believe is important to make a good rebuild effort for Ukraine while the war is going on, and also thinking of what opportunities will evolve when peace has come. The important milestone on this first level is the Ukraine Recovery Conference that is a part of a series of conferences which has started 3 years back in Lugano. And basically they have started already before the war as investment and accession conferences together with Ukraine. And since 3 years, they have focused very much on rebuild of Ukraine since the war started. There was Lugano conference, there was a conference in London, and now it's our pleasure and our honor, no, maybe not our pleasure, but our honor to host the conference in Berlin from the German government together with Ukraine government. And there's also the ambition to bring public participants and private participants together. And we will have a pre-conference full-day event in Berlin on this one, where we cover different aspects around topics like the green energy transformation, for example, which was also highlighted in the energy sector as an important investment opportunity. We will talk about development of economy in general, where this this webinar is a good example for of the many perspectives that need to be taken into consideration in order to develop the economy of Ukraine. And we will also highlight talent workforce topics, because With all the money that might be spent or is spent already into Ukraine and in Ukraine, it's definitely key that the talent dimension is properly considered, because without hands and minds of people, all the money will not unfold in the way it is supposed to. On the next level, we are closely aligning with global organizations. In Germany in particular, we have a close alliance with GIZ as our developmental partner from German government. And you see here USAID as another important branch that we are serving on the ground in international projects, meaning we are working with German colleagues, US colleagues, Czech colleagues, and obviously Ukraine colleagues on the ground. So whenever we compose our teams, it's not so much which country are you coming from, but what is your capability that you can bring to the ground. And there is a lot of other organizations like Swedfund from the Swedish government, or like AFD. AFD, please note, it's not the party AFD, but it's the Agence Française Développementaire. So that is a funny confusion that can sometimes rise. So there's a lot of donor organizations that we engage in from the different member firms. And then the engagement on the ground within Deloitte, and obviously reaching out to our clients, goes across all our sectors. So I will not go through all of them, but what makes the rebuild of Ukraine a super intriguing but also super complex exercise is that basically you need to coordinate engagement across all sectors. And yes, there is some highlights from a German lens. However, I believe personally that we as Germans have a valuable contribution for each of those sectors, but we need to properly select them. And on a side remark, maybe in each of these sectors, there is something and a lot of things for us to learn from Ukraine. So there is a tendency to look at Ukraine like a developmental country, which is not the case, but especially, for example, in digitization of public services. If I look at the Dear app that is available in Ukraine for citizens, this is truly an example how digitization of public services should look like in Germany. So there is a lot of opportunity to learn from Ukraine. So make it a twofold and two-way exercise, which is quite interesting and will make this a great journey for us jointly. Finally, on the align level, we are closely collaborating with all the mentioned institutions there, and there are a lot of more. So we understand ourselves as an open network to really help bringing together the relevant parties across the different dimensions of the rebuild required. And this whole thing, maybe on a conclusive remark, is our proposal and our platform that we have built over the past 1.5 years as a global firm to help businesses on local level engage in Ukraine and also help Ukraine engage in the respective European or international territories. So to also make this a beneficial exercise for both sides. Maybe we go to the last slide. If there is one left, I don't recall. Yeah, this highlights, I think, the breadth of our network all across the globe. And the important point about is not the size that we have, but the important point is the level of mobilization that we have, because regardless of which country you are in, and regardless of which sector you are looking into, and regardless of which topic you would like to cover, I firmly believe that we have an expert from the country, be it in Ukraine or be it in the relevant territory. And for Germany, this means particular that we believe that we are the partner of choice to help any business endeavor out of Ukraine into Germany and the other way around. And this is what makes me really proud to serve this initiative from a European standpoint, to help our clients navigate this obviously very tricky and also geopolitically tricky situation that we are all in. But definitely, we as Deloitte want to make a difference in this, and it would be an honor for us to help any of you representing different companies to help you joining this journey. With that said, I leave it open to all of us, I would say, now to conclude or get other questions.
Thank you, Fabian. We've got another question in the chat related to corruption scandals popping up in media. Let me try to answer this question, even though it's quite a complicated one. And I want to comment that, first of all, you have to carefully analyze all corruption-related news. Sometimes it's just bright headlines. Sometimes it's Russian propaganda, and you have to be very careful with our current information field these days. Sometimes it's politics games, but yes, corruption exists. And first of all, my general observation and personal opinion is that things are getting better during last years, and our anti-corruption bodies in Ukraine works hard on that. And we are, as a consultants and attorneys law, do our job, and we also communicate and cooperate with the government so that our clients, our investors, do not face such corruption challenges, and clear rules of the game that are guaranteed to the companies in a specific legal mechanism that we revealed today, they also help us to avoid these problems.
And maybe to add on that, Vasily, go ahead.
Yeah, I will just add briefly that I have lived in Ukraine for all my life, and I had an opportunity to watch how Ukraine transformed over the time. And I would say that 20 years ago, corruption was almost ubiquitous through all of the Ukrainian state systems. Right now, it's just certain cases and high-profile cases which are legitimate. For me, they only indicate that the war on corruption is going on, because like 10 years ago, nobody would even bother to investigate this case. Right now, it's all over the news, everybody's enraged. And that's, for me, is an indication that Ukraine is on the right path. And indeed, it gotten much more better in this respect, but there is, of course, a lot of work to be done. And as Dmitry said, our governmental institutions are trying their best right now.
And maybe to add one point, because I'm obviously not in the position to judge on level of corruption likeliness in Ukraine. But what I would like to highlight is that we as Deloitte, and I'm talking now as a strategy consultant who's advising clients on what makes sense in terms of business growth opportunities, but I'm part of this global network that has a big risk branch and a big forensic branch and a big tax branch, obviously. And what I can share on this particular topic is that we as Deloitte are very carefully investigating, as you said, Dimitro, the surroundings of any of our advice and tax contributions that we do to our clients to make sure that the specific project goes in line with everything that we can figure out on the surroundings and make it safe and sure for our clients and for ourselves, obviously, because reputation is the biggest value that we have to bring to the table, but also to lose in this particular context.
Thank you, Fabian. Just to add, we as Deloitte Ukraine now work under large anti-corruption programs and projects, also supported and sponsored by various European governments and with anti-corruption programs for the government of Ukraine and for Ukrainian municipalities. And really don't want to go deeper in specific cases and specific names, but Ukraine is a state governed by the rule of law, and the presumption of innocence applies, so the guilt should be determined by the court. But anyway, thank you for your question. And as you started it saying Slava Ukraini, I just want to reply again, Героям Слава. Thank you.
Okay, I will take over at this stage. First of all, thank you very much for your participation. As several times mentioned, that was a kickoff. That was not the last one. Well, that was the first one. As Fabian Dimitrov and the others also mentioned, our intention is to go deeper in the next webcast. Yeah, in this respect, yeah. We are really very appreciating your feedback. It would be good, yeah, also to get feedback from your side. So if you have any topic, any question or any remark, feel free to come back to us. Yeah, because from our perspective, our intention is not only to speak, but also to listen to you, to understand your needs, and also to give you the right advice, the right answer to your needs. Ukraine is for us a hard topic, hot topic, and as Fabian mentioned, yeah, we are prepared. We have a good setup on a global basis, on a regional level, but also on a local level. And in this respect, hopefully, you enjoyed the session. You got also a number of new ideas, also new spirit. Yeah. How we can move Ukraine in a better future. In this respect, yeah, I would like to say many thanks to all of our colleagues for the presentations and also for the contributions. I would like to say also thank you, many thanks to the team who has organized this session. Yeah, so we have a number of Ukrainians also here in Germany. And I can tell you they are very excited to be part of this initiative, also to organize this webcast. And in this respect, again, I would like to say thank you very much for your participation. And all of us are in the boat to create a better future for Ukraine. And in this respect, yeah. We are looking forward to being in touch with you also in the future. Thank you very much.